I have been told that the best crackers in the world can do this in 60 minutes. Unfortunately, I need someone who can do it in 60 seconds.
You're kidding. Go!
Format strings, one of the most interesting exploit development techniques, which I'll be talking about in 6 videos, and will release each every week on Friday. I won't be using any existing code or executables, and instead will provide my own as examples of vulnerable software. I'll share the source code and relevant system configurations, as well as compiler options used, for you to be able to recreate the vulnerable payload and environment. I'll be explaining the whole concept in a 32-bit system, which requires smaller payloads and is therefore easier to learn from. And then in video 6, we'll explain the adjustments you need to put on your exploitation code in order to be able to convert existing exploits or write your own from scratch. Well, the table of contents is pretty self-explanatory, so let's get into it. Before that, make sure to subscribe to be notified on new releases. In this section, we'll be testing the vulnerable1.c application. As you can see, this simply validates a password and either grants you access or not. Looking at this code, it just validates a password. As you can see here, I'm using Caesar's cipher with key 1, just to keep it simple, but the point here is that I wanted a proof of concept code that had the password in the stack for us to be able to dump using format strings. Securely storing a password is not the point here, so I just didn't want to give you a binary where you could simply use the strings command to dump the password, even though you can see the password using dynamic analysis tools such as ltrace, but again, not really the point here. So what's a format string? A format string is composed of ordinary characters and conversion specifiers. Ordinary characters are those copied unchanged to the output stream, whereas the conversion specifiers, easily identifiable by a percentage character, will specify a data type, which will tell the printf function how to retrieve that data in stack. Looking at the code on this final printf, what happens in terms of parameter placement is that the buffer string pointer will be pushed to stack, and then the pointer to the string, the first parameter, will be pushed to stack as well, right before the call to printf. So the printf function will simply read whatever string is given as the first parameter and read the stack as it finds conversion specifiers. To see how this works in more detail, you ought to take a look at the printf definition. While it might seem like someone got lazy while documenting this, they didn't. This is known as a varying length function because you define it once, and it will accommodate any number of parameters. A varying length parameter is defined like this. Here we have a function that will accept any number of integers and return the smallest one. A relevant piece of code here is this, where you tell the varargs macro how to increment the pointer to the stack in order for it to fetch the next argument. Obviously, you might be reading an integer, which is 4 bytes long, or some other data type, which could be longer, but we'll get back to this in a bit. The crucial thing to note here is that we as programmers are the ones responsible to tell the function how many parameters it has to fetch from the stack. And this is the issue here. If we tell the function to fetch more variables than we put up in stack, it'll just keep on reading the stack. And this is exactly the problem with printf. While it doesn't have a count number in its first parameter, what it has is a string with conversion specifiers. So if you just place more of those than the number of parameters, it'll start printing out the stack. So basically, in order for you to be able to exploit this, you must have control over the first parameter string. Let's see this working. Let's type %x. This will print out the next 4 bytes in stack as an hexadecimal number. But as you might imagine, typing multiple of these is not convenient, so let's use Python to help us here. Just to show you that these are the values in stack, we can look at GDB to confirm. A I'll just set a breakpoint here before the vulnerable printf, run the 100 percentage checks, and we'll look at the stack. There you go. You can see that it matches perfectly. Now, keep in mind this perfect match is only happening because I have ASLR disabled in the system, as it is not relevant for learning how to exploit this, but I'll talk more about it later in the series. So you might have noticed that part of the password is being shown here in stack. That's because it is there. If you remember the code, you can see that the password string is being stored in a local variable, which are stored in stack. An important distinction to be made here is between values and references, which are placed in stack. Some variables, like integers, are stored as value. So if such a variable was storing value 1, that's exactly what you'd see in stack. Much like a character array, which is stored byte by byte, each corresponding to an ASCII character in the stack. So when you look at the previous 104-byte values being dumped from the stack...
Stop. Go in on that. Use that as a key.
Yeah, sure. Sweet. Thanks, James. At this point, you might be wondering why didn't I just use the character specifier percentage C, or even the string specifier percentage S? Well, because in this case, you won't be able to retrieve the data. Let's get back to the Python code and replace the percentage X with percentage C. Instead of the password, what you see is a 3, 4, and 0, which are the numbers in our password. So how come? Remember the hexadecimal prints from percentage X? The thing about the character specifier is that it won't just grab a byte from the stack, as one would assume. It actually grabs 4 bytes, as you can see in the printf definition in libc. This means that it is actually eating chunks of 4 bytes out of the stack, while printing out just the lowest byte, which is why you see the 3, 4, and 0 printed out. What about percentage s? Also can't be used because the value of the string, meaning each character, is what's placed in the stack. But in order to read it with percentage s, there would have to be a pointer to that string. Let's see such a case, as it is quite common. In this one, I changed the code in order to have the pointer to the string in the stack instead of the actual string value. So let's try and use Python as before, but using percentage s. However, we now get a segmentation fault as we're trying to illegally access a page in memory. So how is this happening? Well, the best way to debug this is always through the debugger, obviously. In this case, given the context, we'll go back to the Python code and put back the percentage x. When we run it, you see what value is being read in the stack, and because it's percentage s, it will use it as a pointer to a position in memory and try to access the string there. However, the value there is 200, which obviously is not a valid memory address and hence the segmentation fault. So how do we overcome this? By using something called direct parameter access, which is a very useful feature from the printf implementation in libc, and something very few people have actually used before learning about format strings exploitation. Imagine you want to write a simple program and print out the values of x, y, and x again. Now, this would probably be what would come up in your head at first, but one can imagine how this is not ideal in a low memory system, which I'd imagine is why they came up with this at first. Because if you're printing out the same value multiple times, you'll have to repeatedly place that value in memory. But using direct parameter access, you don't have to. So what does this mean for us trying to dump a string with a pointer in stack? This means we can use bash to cycle through the execution of the application. So if it crashes, it's just an iteration in the cycle that goes out the window, but you still check for the other positions. And there you go. You can see that in position 6, there's the password. Not only that, but you can retrieve some more information like environment variables that are placed in stack as well. Another relevant piece of information are parameters placed in the command line, typically accessed via argc and argv, which are also placed in the stack. You can see that if this process is a remote application binded to a port, how much sensitive information you can actually grab from that system just by reading the stack on that process. Now we can get back to our Python script and use direct parameter access to directly access the relevant string pointer. Also, note that this can be quite useful if you have buffer size restrictions in play. So there you go. Hopefully you value the power of reading the stack more now. Next, we'll look into how you can write to memory using this exploitation technique.